Today is Sunday. The Seder is 2 weeks from tomorrow night. And you're sitting here. And I'd like you to take a moment to reflect on that. It's the main thing, right? Just pretend you close your eyes like a little kid. You can't see me. You know, so if you don't look, maybe it'll go away. Yeah. I don't know. At some point, Pesach became so overwhelming. My mother passed away just over a month ago, and she was 89. And I told someone she was 89, they go, "Can I know her?" I said, "It's a little too late for that." But in that generation, you never heard people kvetching, "Oh yeah, I got to make Pesach, I got to make Shabbos, I got to handle this." Yeah, everyone did what they had to do. Nobody kvetched, they did what they have to. Today, it's a whole different generation, you know? I know for myself, if I get out of bed in the morning, I expect a round of applause, you know what I mean? Because everything is so difficult for us. It's just so overwhelming. We find things overwhelming, you know? And the idea of making Pesach, you know, especially if you grew up, you know, in a house that's slightly insane, you know, where they're using toothbrushes and toothpicks and, you know what I mean, to be able to pick out, you know, everything everywhere. And you wonder how many pieces of bread actually stuck to the trisim, you know what I mean? And the cleaning for Pesach, the worst part of it is not even the cleaning. Cleaning is not so bad. It's going through all the old junk mail and all the magazines and everything. And what am I going to keep? And I was really going to read this, you know? And I have to go sorting and going through. There are people who, if they have little kids, they change over the clothes from the winter clothes to the summer clothes, and as soon as you do, you know it's going to be freezing temperature and raining. You know, happens all the time. It doesn't change, you know. And it seems so overwhelming, you know, that it is very easy to lose the forest for the trees, and starting with all the cleaning. Now, the year my father passed away, which was 20 years ago, my mother died 20 years and 6 days after my father. So so my mother always went away to this Pesach hotel. So she nudged them so that they would bring me as a scholar in residence, you know. And that's a whole different experience. You have to appreciate this because I have 8 girls. This is the reason I became a world famous speaker, because the only chance I have of getting the bathroom myself, you know, is when I'm in a different country. But, they have to get clothes, you know, when you go away, you know, you need clothes, you know, you need clothes to dress up, and you have to wear more than one outfit a day, you know what I mean? And then you need casual clothes, and you need Chol Hamoed clothes, which are casual, but not too casual, you know, and then you need, you know, in case it's hot, and then because it's cold, and in case it rains, you know, so there's usually a gigantic Greyhound bus following after our family with all the luggage, you know, by the time we get there. So the shopping and that, I'd much rather scrub the oven, you know, than to have to, you know, go through this this process. But okay, it's all the packing, you know. So you choose what you're going to do. All the shopping for the clothing and the packing, or if you stay home, all the cleaning and the shopping and the cooking. And I thought that it's a choice. I realized it's not. Because my mother, years ago, my brother rented a house in Orlando and took my mother. And my mother wanted to go again, but towards the end, she was not very mobile, and she needed aids. And my brother said, "I'm not taking you. It's too hard to deal with you. You know, you make Pesach in your house, and we'll all come over for the Seder, and that's good enough." So my mother called everybody and says, "Nobody will take me to Orlando, you know?" So my wife says, "Listen, this might be the last year." Turns out that was prescient, you know? So we decided we're going to take my mother to Orlando. So this is great, because not only do you get to do all the packing and the schlepping, you also get to do all the cooking and the cleaning and the serving. I don't get it. I really don't. It's beyond me. So I let my kids all go on the Chol Hamoed trips. I stayed home with my mother, you know, made her a matzah brie and an egg cream. She was very happy, you know, played backgammon, you know? And that's it. And everybody else went off to, you know, to go to Disneyland and, you know, and Universal and all these exciting rides. You know, we wait online for 45 minutes to be strapped into a machine that's going to hurl you upside down 100 miles an hour backwards in the dark. Like, that holds any appeal for me. I live in Israel. I could just take a taxi and have the same experience. I don't have to wait online, you know? So, so it's all this preparation, and it's so easy. You see people come to the Seder, and they just pass out because they're exhausted from all the preparation and all the work that goes into it. And so here I am in this hotel. Now, Erev Pesach, I grew up with a certain sense of Erev Pesach, you know? And I felt that, you know, if you grew up with an Erev Pesach, it's one of the greatest things you can do. I was asked to take over the bar mitzvah class in a Hebrew school in America, an afternoon Talmud Torah Hebrew school. Just so you appreciate what this educational experience is, the head for Jews for Jesus once said, "I wish I had enough money to send every Jewish kid to afternoon Hebrew school, because that's the best way to turn them into a Christian." So it's a really difficult thing. Now, I had the bar mitzvah class, which is like Agatha Christie's 10 Little Indians. Each one gets bar mitzvah and they disappear, you know what I mean? And I'm watching the class shrink, you know? Open parentheses, a priest and a minister and a rabbi walked into a bar. They said, "What are you doing here?" They said, "We came to make a joke." But that's not this one. Yeah, they get together to discuss various communal problems. So the priest says, "I don't know what to do. We have bats in the belfry of the church, and we don't know how to get rid of them. We called in exterminators. It doesn't work." The minister said, "You know, we have the same problem. We have church mice, and we called in exterminators. It doesn't help." The rabbi said, "You know, in the attic of the shul, we have pigeons, but I got rid of them." He says, "How'd you do it?" So I chased them all into the shul, gave them a bar mitzvah. They flew away and never came back. Yeah. So that's the story. I had this bar mitzvah class, and as each one got bar mitzvah, they disappeared. So by the time Pesach's coming around, the class was somewhat lean and mean. So the PTA gives me a budget to make a model Seder. I don't know how many of you went through a model Seder. You remember the model Seder, that wonderful educational technique where one little kid dresses up like the grandfather and one little kid dresses up like the little kid, which, by the way, is not so hard, you know what I mean? And somebody dresses up like the grandmother, you know, and they sit down to the Seder, you know, and they say the Manish Tana, and they sing Dayenu, and they eat a piece of gefilte fish, and they eat a lettuce leaf, and they eat a piece of matzah, and they drink some grape juice, you know what I mean? And, you know, they sing Chad Gadya, you know, it's very cute when you're in third grade. But by the time you're in seventh, eighth grade and your bar mitzvah, it's getting a little hokey. So I looked at these kids. They were not the very strongly motivated group. So I said to the PTA, "I'd like to use the money on a different Pesach project." They said, "Go ahead." So the kids came in. They said, "Hey, where's the model Seder?" I said, "Go to the bathroom, wash your hands with soap, and come back." And I put out a plastic tablecloth, and I put out a grinder, and I said, "We're going to make horseradish." And I said, "Oh, it comes in those little jars." I said, "Well, this is an educational experience, you know." And they started grating it, you know, and you know how it works. You start crying. You wait till there's enough in the bowl, and you stick it under your brother's nose. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's like these are things you grow up with, you know. So rinse out the grinders. Now we're going to make charoses. It comes in little tubes, you know, those little envelopes. I said, you poor culturally denied children. I said, "I'm going to show you how to make charoses." You know, we grind it up. I brought in a little thing. We made the zraya. We made the egg. It was really something very special. And kids came to life because it was something real. It was something real. And I realized that is the essential message of the Pesach Seder. So now I put that, close parentheses, I go back to my story. So it's Erev Pesach. And, you know, we all know Erev Pesach, such a busy time. Here we are in the hotel. People are swimming, people are playing tennis, people are in the weight room, you know what I mean? Typical Erev Pesach experiences. There's also, of course, eating. And they also offer classes for people who are more interested. And in front of the dining room, there was a class on napkin folding. And also me. And I was on the side also giving a class upstairs. Yeah. And I said, you know, we put so much time and so much preparation in getting ready for the Seder. And when we come to the Seder, so there is a mitzvah for you to talk to your children and a mitzvah for your children to listen to you. Can you imagine one day a year? You know, somebody asked me once about Lag BaOmer. How do you explain Lag BaOmer? And if you haven't been in Lag BaOmer for Israel yet, you know, well, are you in for a surprise? You know, because you see they build these gigantic pyres like to burn a Greek god, you know, 100 feet up. And everybody who's involved in the construction and running of it are under 6 years old. You know what I mean? And they're dragging these trees and running around with bottles of gasoline. And the adults are all hiding in their houses. They're too afraid to come out, you know? So they said, "How do you explain that?" I said, "Well, you know, Judaism is a little restrictive. So we try to have one day for every deviant behavior, you know? So if you have OCD, we have Pesach, you know? And if you're an alcoholic, we have Purim. And if you're a pyromaniac, we have Lag BaOmer, you know? We try to have something for everybody, you know? That's why kids who are always being shushed in shul, you know? So they come on Purim and they get to make as much noise as they want, you know? It's just unbelievable, you know? So I said, you know, so there's one day a year that we're supposed to talk to our kids and they're supposed to listen. Yeah, and now this is it. It's coming down to the Seder. Did you give any thought to what you want to say? Or are you going to give the same Seder that you've given 5 years ago and 10 years ago and 20 years ago? There's an old expression that there's a lawyer with 10 years experience and a lawyer with 1 year experience 10 times. Right? What does that mean? That means that if you just keep filling out the same forms year after year, you're not any smarter than you were in the first year. Yeah? The same thing is true of a Seder. If the Seder experience is the same experience year after year, and I didn't give any thought into what I want to say, I'm doing a disservice to all of the participants. Now, let me explain this. I speak around the world to students. Last May, I went to Australia. That was my first time. I've been in South Africa. I've been around Europe, England, America, Canada, and I always ask them, what did you find frustrating about your Jewish education? And they always say it wasn't relevant. Whether they went to the finest yeshivas or they had 1 hour in a Hebrew school, it's not relevant to my life, right? Kid goes to school, anyone who's had a little kid who ever had to learn Gemara, you must have had this conversation at some point. Why do I need to know this? I don't have an ox and I'm not planning on buying one, you know? I don't run through the street with pitchers. If I decide to marry a woman, it'll be with a ring, not with a piece of silk of indeterminate value. And if I divorce her, it's going to be in Basin. I'm not going to throw the get from my roof into her courtyard where it catches on fire on the way down. Why do I need to study these things? Now, the truth is, that's a good question, which we're not going to answer. But I'm going to raise a lot of good questions that I'm not going to answer. But we call that job security. But the idea is that people want it to be meaningful. Particularly when it comes to the Seder. I was saying this over when I used to teach in Rosh Hashanah, and a guy says, why does that have to be relevant? What are you knocking everybody out for? It's a cute custom, you know, that people do. So what if it doesn't have any relevance? I said, you mean like a Navajo Indian rain dance? Right? It doesn't have any particular meaning, and you're just doing it. He was right. So what do we say at the end of Magid? When we finish the whole story part, and we're now to the exciting, you know, eating the matzah part, yeah? In every generation, you have to see yourself as if you came out of Egypt. What does that mean? That means that the Seder is not a commemoration, it's a recreation. It means that whatever the Exodus experience was, it's not that we're remembering it, we're supposed to relive it. And that is a very hard thing to do if people are saying over interesting insights from 20 years ago, or 40 years ago, or 100 years ago. Is there a message that's relevant in my life in the year 2017? And if there's not, I'm going to sit at a Seder and it's not going to be interesting and engaging. And the messages are timeless, right? We just have to figure out how to bring it across. Rav Meir Shapiro from Chachmei Lublin, he once said an interesting thing. Moshe made for himself trumpets that were used to assemble the people and assemble the officers and, you know, to bring different messages. And when he died, they were buried with him, because every leader has to make his own chatzotros, has to make his own trumpets. And Rav Meir Shapiro said, because the message remains the same, but the means of bringing it out has to change in every generation. And what worked 100 years ago is not going to work today. And the messages that might have worked are not going to work now. You know, so we have to temper the message for a generation in 2017. And whether those people are ourselves or our children or our grandchildren or guests, we have to say something that's going to be meaningful to them, that's going to engage them. Now, I actually gave 2-3 hour classes on how to give insights into the Haggadah. I don't think we're going to do that this evening. But I want to at least make the point that this is our challenge. And we're going to focus on a few points. But the challenge is that it has to be something that's going to be meaningful for us. So let's capture the Seder experience, right? I can't speak for everybody. I can speak for my own experience, and everybody can tell you themselves. You come home from shul, and now you have to try to get everybody to the table. This is a major undertaking, yeah? Once they get at the table, we have to start fighting over where everyone is going to sit, you know? Some people want to sit next to Abba. Some people specifically do not want to sit next to Abba, you know, and where we're going to go. So once we figure out where we're going to sit, now comes the fight about the chairs, because there's only two chairs with arms. Abba gets one. Everyone's fighting over who's going to get the other chair, right? Okay. Now comes the pillow fight, yeah, because everybody wants a pillow to lean on, even though they don't have anything to lean on it. And nobody wants to take their own pillows, so they take everybody else's pillows, and everybody gets angry, you know, until they have the pillows, and then everybody is ready for the pillows. Now comes the wine grape juice discussion. This takes 20 minutes all by itself, because you know you're supposed to have wine, but if I drink wine, I'm going to get a headache, so maybe I'll have grape juice, maybe I'll mix it a little bit, no, maybe a little more, and that's too much already, okay, switch it, you know, and people are supposed to pour for each other, you know, so they're fighting, you didn't pour for me, I pour for you, pour for Vori, right, you know, everybody's pouring till you have that all done, right? Now you have to take out the matzahs, so you can find three that sort of meet our criteria, you know, we sit it all down. And now we make Kiddush. Everybody makes Kiddush, even people for whom Hebrew is not even their third language, you know? And everybody is very long time till we get to the Kiddush, right? Then we go and we wash, and we have the karpas, yeah? And then we have the Manish Tana, and everybody under the age of 40 says the Manish Tana. And they say it in Hebrew, and they say it in English, and they say it in Yiddish, and my sister-in-law says it in Spanish, and somebody else says it in Swahili, you know? And any way you can possibly say it, you say the Manish Tana, right? And now, if you're lucky enough to have a yeshiva bacher at your seder, he brings out his first box of notes. Boom. And the tension begins to rise in the room. And you can start to sense that this is a seder that is in trouble. The way you can always find that is when the father starts assigning roles at the four sons. Russia, Mahu Omer. I didn't do anything. Me, I was looking at you. Yeah. Anyway, so things are starting to deteriorate. So there's always one person at the Seder. It could be an uncle, it could be a cousin, it could be a friend who knows this is their job. They see what's happening, and at some point they go, "That's it, let's go." And everyone goes, how do you know there were 10 plagues of the sea, 50 plagues of the sea, 20 plagues of the sea, 250 plagues of the sea, sold? Dayenu. Dayenu is the most annoying tune in the entire world. And the words don't even bother fitting in, right? Elu, 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 Sarkeda, Bamidba, Boyim, Shana, Dayenu. Yeah, that's going to really flow right off the tongue, you know? So, you know, you're getting through all this. And as you're mumbling through, it's absolutely amazing, yeah? You come to the following paragraph, which is, in fact, a Mishnah. In, by the way, a quick advertisement, yeah? I found these Haggadahs at some point where it's just the text. You can write in anything that you think is interesting that you want to raise and bring up. Throughout the whole Haggadah, it's just pages of where you can write in your own ideas and things. And I bought this one year for one of my kids. You can see they used it a little bit, you know, wrote in some ideas. Yeah, I never did that. What are they writing? All right, anyway. But where's my will? Anyway. So among that, when you reach that second half, where we're sort of on the flow already, Rabbi Gamliel, how you aimer? Kol mishloah mishloshet dvarim elu bePesach lo yotzei dechavosai. Anyone who didn't say these three things on Pesach is not yotzei. Mana 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 mana. And what are they? Pesach, matzah, umara. Halacha. Halacha. A guy, his wife, decided to give birth on Seder night. Because some women have no consideration whatsoever. So he had a very short amount of time left to be able to make his Seder. The halacha is, somebody says the Manish Tana, if there's nobody there, you say it yourself, you say Avodah Mayino, and then you cut to Rabbi Gamliel Ya Omer. Because this is the essence of the Haggadah. Rabbi Gamliel said, it's a Mishnah in Pesachim in the 10th parak, anyone who doesn't say these three things are not Yotzei. According to the Rambam, it means you're not Yotzei the mitzvah min a muvcha, you didn't do the mitzvah the best way. According to the Ran, Rabbeinu Nisim, you're not Yotzei, period. If you missed this part, then you missed the whole story of Yetzias Mitzrayim. Pesach, Matzah, and Mara. These three things are essentially the concepts of what Pesach is all about. These are the three themes that we have to try to be able to capture. Now, I want to try to focus a little bit on them this evening so that we get a little bit of an insight into what we hope to understand from these things. And I'm going to point out when we come to one of them, we really don't understand that much. Yeah? Okay. Pesach. Now, Pesach is one of the hardest ones, obviously, because we don't have Beis HaMikdash anymore, and we don't have a Korban Pesach. And in fact, one of the four questions was, on all other nights, we eat boiled, baked, or roasted meat. Today, we only eat roasted. We took that question out, because it's not true anymore. That was when we had the Korban Pesach. And that's why, by the way, in case you think that, you know, you have people over for the holidays, you know, it gets a little crowded, especially in these Israeli apartments that we now live in. You know, in our country of origin, probably most of us had houses, you know, and had a little bit of room to move in. You know, now you're trying to bring all your furniture, stick it into a three-bedroom apartment. You know what I mean? So you're basically just like working like this, you know. And then the company comes, you know, for Pesach. I was invited over to somebody's house. They had four kids. Each kid had their own bedroom. Nobody could double up. We had to sleep in the living room on a couch bed. So, because everyone needs their room. They need their space, you know. So when I came in, you know, we had two bedrooms for the kids. We put two bunk beds in each one, you know, and that's how we lived. And everybody was happy or else. But that's nothing. I mean, you know, people used to live in, especially in Israel, in these tiny little apartments, really tiny. So a friend of mine who was in yeshiva, he told me that he had a friend who was a Taimani. And he went over to his house, and he had one of these, like, you know, development town, you know, these little tiny apartments. So he says, which is your room? He says, what do you mean? He says, well, where do you sleep? He goes, where do I find a bed? I find a bed, that's where I go to sleep. Open parentheses, Rebbe Yoshev, he only had one room, like a living room, and a kitchen. And so when there were only enough beds for half the kids, so half of them would stay up all night and learn, and the other ones would sleep, and when they got up to go to yeshiva, the other kids came and went to bed. So, you know, they took turns, they had shifts, you know, when it's crowded like that. But so he says, where do you sleep? He goes, where do I find a bed? I go to sleep. He says, but where's your stuff? I got some over here, some over there, you know. He says, this is okay. He says, but on the Chagim, when the whole extended family come, then it gets crowded. He says, so what do you do? So we put up a curtain in the living room, and all the men sleep here, and all the women sleep there, and that's how we do it, you know. So we think it's kind of crowded now, you know. It's not too late. We still have enough time that, you know, basically this gets built, we'll bring a Korban Pesach, you know. You have to eat it within the walls of the old city of Yerushalayim. And you can't be on a second or third story. You have to be on the ground level. Now, so that you appreciate this, the Gemara says that one year they did a count how many Korban Pesachs there were. There was 1.2 million that were brought. And somebody made a cheshbon that about 50 people could eat from a Korban Pesach. So let's say that there were 50 million. You know, let's say it was only 25 million, you know. In the old city, having your Seder with people all around you, you know. Certainly, if as they say in Hebrew, if you're looking for action, soon I'll be able to speak Hebrew. because it's just becoming more and more English words with a bad accent, you know what I mean? Iction, you know? So you probably realize when you try to learn the language, you read the newspaper, you don't understand half the words until you realize they're English words that they've written out, you know? And Riti Tse Pamaiti Bashok, they met, you know? And minimum, maximum, individuali, coalizia, you know? I said, why are you wasting your time? You know, why don't you switch to English? You know, there's nothing left to Hebrew. And the Israeli said to me, Ani aptimi. So there you go, my friends. In any event, you have to really be able to get that all in. But okay, so we don't have a Korban Pesach now. That would be on the Seder table. That was the highlight of the Seder, obviously. Now instead we get to eat an extra piece of matzah. Mm-mm. Yeah. So I read you the paragraph. Pesach shoya avoseno ochlum bezman shebeis mikdash hayakayim al shomo. Why do they eat the Korban Pesach? Al shom she posach HaKadosh Baruch Hu abode avoseno Mitzrayim. Because God passed over the houses of our fathers in Egypt. This is a Pesach offering to God. Because he struck the houses of the Egyptians and our houses he saved. Now this begs a question. I imagine God knew where all the Jews lived. Yeah, he was very good at that. And in fact, if you're not sure, just check. Horowitz, yeah. Moskowitz, Hala Habubu, get him. Greenberg, fine, you know. Al Hamanana, get him. It should be easy enough. God needs us to write the blood on the doorpost so he knows where they are so he could save us. Interesting. Rashi brings this down. They did not put the blood on the outside of the door. They put it on the inside of the door. Because God knew where the Jews lived, the Jews didn't know where the Jews lived. And this was the unbelievable moment. Yeah. 80% of the Jews died in the darkness of Egypt. This is my own idea. You do not have to accept it. It's definitely not the simple understanding, but something that makes sense to me. It says during the 3 day of darkness, God killed out the 80% of the Jews because they weren't worthy to come out of Egypt at that time. And why did he do it during the 3 days of darkness? So the Egyptians shouldn't notice. 600,000 men between the ages of 20 and 60 came out. So if you add in children, you add in adults, you add in all the women, it's at least 3 million, maybe closer to 5 million. 3 million people. I mean, 12 million died in 3 days. And when the lights came back on, the Egyptians didn't notice. Hey, where'd everybody go? They're out. Be back soon, I'm sure. You know, where'd all those new graves? Oh, graves? I didn't know there was any graves. You know, it's kind of strange. So darkness can also mean gullus. Darkness can mean the uncertainty and being lost. There's very easy to be lost in the darkness of Egypt without having to die. If you make a calculation of how many Jews still exist in the world today, going from mother to mother to mother, right? Tens of million, if not more. Yeah, an enormous amount. And yet, we know that the Jewish population is 12 million, you know, 8 million, 6 million, depends who you talk to, you know what I mean? You know, 14 million, whatever number you want to give. But it's certainly not the tens of millions who should be here. They were lost in the darkness. They disappeared. There's something that is very hard to do. I share with you, again, my own insight. Yeah? There's a set of mitzvos that are given in Parshas Ki Tsetse. First it says, if you're walking in the woods and you see a bird, chase away the bird and take the eggs or the little birds. That's the first mitzvah. The second mitzvah is don't plow with a ox and a donkey together. And the next mitzvah is, the one before that is put a roof on top of your house. That's it. Put a gate on top of your house so no one falls off. The next one is don't plow with an ox and a donkey together. The next mitzvah is don't plant wheat together with your vineyard. And the last one is put tzitzis on your clothing. So what's the connection? So Rashi says this is what it means in Pirkei Avos, mitzvah gereres mitzvah. One mitzvah leads to another. If you chase away the mother bird, you'll get a house. And if you put up a fence, you'll get a field. And if you follow the laws with that, you'll get a vineyard. And if you keep the vineyard, the laws of the vineyard, then you'll get nice clothing. So what's mitzvah gereres mitzvah? What's the connection? What are you? It can't be by harder. I think it's definitely harder to have to climb up into a tree and chase away a mother bird or to build, you know, a fence on top of your roof than it is not to plant wheat in your vineyard. I think that's a little easier, you know, or to put on a pair of tzitzis. It can't be from difficulty. I wanted to say it's because of commitment. The mitzvah shliach hakan of chasing away the mother bird can only be done in a hefka place. It can't be some place that you own. It's not on your property. Yeah? I've had this, other people have had this, where pigeons made a nest on one of my windowsills, and they're a kosher bird. So I could do the mitzvah shliach hakan. But the first thing I had to do is bring around three people and make my windowsill hefka. So it's an ownerless place. Yeah, so far nobody's gone and grabbed my windowsill, but, you know, to be able to do it. It has to be someplace out in the middle of nowhere. That's the first mitzvah God gives you. One that doesn't really touch your life so much. It's out in the middle of the woods. Nobody has to know about it. Yeah, but if you show that you're interested, God's going to give you another opportunity. Put a fence on top of your house. Now I'm going to tell you how to live in your house. If you accept that, now I'm going to step into your business. I'm going to tell you how to run your business. I'm going to tell you what business you can go into and what you can't. And if you accept that, then I'm going to tell you what you can wear. Mitzvah gereres mitzvahs. Yeah, it was Mendelssohn, founder of Reform Judaism, who said, be a Jew in your home and a German in the street. Yeah, don't let everybody see it. Don't let everybody know what you're doing. You know, be quiet about it. You know, hide your Judaism. I grew up in a conservative synagogue, you know. My father used to say, you know, an Orthodox Jew wears a yarmulke. A Reformed Jew doesn't wear a yarmulke, right? We lived in North America, and the Reformed Temple in Merrick, they would not give you an aliyah if you were wearing a yarmulke. Yeah. He says, and a conservative Jew like me, you carry one in your pocket. So when you need it, you have it, you know what I mean? But you don't wear it all the time, you know? You don't want to have to stand out. You know, it's this old Yiddish man who had worked very hard to be able to fit in to American society. You know, he's on the train and he sees this chassid. And he's so enraged and he starts yelling at him in Yiddish. Why do you have to dress that way? Why do you have to act this way? You just embarrass us. You separate us from everybody. When he finishes yelling, he, you know, shrugs and says in a slightly German-accented English, excuse me, sir, I don't understand what you're saying. I'm Amish. So he says, oh, I'm very sorry. I have a lot of respect for religion. And Rabbi Twersky says to him, yeah, for other people's religion, not for yours. You know, it's, you can check it on YouTube. Jon Stewart used to have a television show called The Daily Show. Someone else took it over. But he, in the Hamptons, there were these secular Jews who were fighting putting up an Erev, you know. So this guy went out to interview him, and he says, we don't want these people in our town, Orthodox Jews, you know, they're going to change our lifestyle. We don't need them here. We don't want them here, you know. He says, you know, some people say that about Jews in general, that they don't want Jews. He says, you can't say that. This is America. Everybody has a right to live here. He says, except them. Right. It makes us uncomfortable. There's no question about it. You know, it's have to be in your face. It's have to be in your face for, you know. So the the sheep was the god of Egypt. And they were commanded to take it on the 10th of the month and tie it to their bedpost. And so the Egyptians hear these sheep bleeding all throughout the town. And they say to the Jews, who were just formerly their slaves, right? They were still under their control, but at least they'd been, you know, let up from the slavery. He says, oh, that's so interesting. I see you've decided to adopt our God. You know, sort of. He says, well, why do you have my God inside of your house? Well, I'm going to slaughter it and eat it, and take the blood, and paint my door. You know? Now you understand how that can get people very upset, you know. This little Jewish kid, he used to get beaten up by these Polish kids. I heard the story from him. And I said to him, I said, why are you beating me up? He says, you killed my God. He says, well, I could kill your God. What do you think I could do to you? But people have been upset at Jews for so many years. You know, we killed their God. You know, they get a little touchy about that. So I have their God in my house, and I make it clear that I'm going to kill it. And the Maharal says, and that's why you have to keep it intact. You can't cut it into pieces. Everyone has to see that it's a sheep, you know? And you have to roast it, because when you boil it, it falls apart. And you have to make sure that it's roasted so you get to see exactly what it is. And everyone knows that we're eating a roasted sheep or goat. And everyone has to see it. And the blood goes in the inside because it's for us. It's very hard to part with, you know, your dominant culture and where you come from. It's very hard, you know. I moved here 28 years ago from America, Long Island, outside of New York, a first world country. And I came to Israel, and a guy said to me, a friend of mine says, I'll help you navigate this. You can ask me where, you can ask me when, you can ask me how. You can never ask why. Kacha. That's the way it is, you know? And it's just absolutely amazing. You know, there's so many things here that just don't seem to make any sense. And we feel like, I can't speak everybody here, we made this tremendous sacrifice to move here, to become part of the Jewish people, etc. And no one seems too thrilled that we're here. You know, I was in the Misrad HaPnim, and those of you who've been there, you know, my condolences. But, you know, it's gotten a lot better. But when I was here 28 years ago, I was trying to get a tax discount on my apartment. And the lawyer says, hey, I'll give you a form. I said, do I have to bring my wife? And they said, no, you know. Now, I know this, that every pakid, unless they send you back at least once, they haven't done their job, you know. So when I go to any office, I bring every document I have. I have my dental records going back to third grade, you know, whatever I can think of, you know. And it doesn't make a difference. They'll send you back for the witch's broomstick, you know what I mean? They don't feel right unless they've made you go back again, you know. So I said, I don't need my wife. He says, no, this is notarized. I'm a lawyer. I'm a notary. I notarize this, that your wife, you know, your wife's signature's on it, and it's fine. You don't need it. So I came. I brought food. I brought reading material. I brought a tent. You know what I mean? Whatever it is. I knew I was going to be there for a while. And eventually my number comes up, you know, and I go up there, and shalom. And I said, I'm here for the tax discount. He says, where's your wife? I said, the lawyer says, I don't need my wife. He says, no, your wife has to be here. Next. Now, I had been here already 3 years, so I started screaming, because that's what they understand. You know what I'm saying? Start screaming. Open parentheses. I went to open a bank account. You know, when you open a bank account in America, they're so happy to see you, they give you a toaster. You know what I mean? They say, what color checks do you want? What kind of checkbook do you want? You know, what number should it start out? Do you want your initials? I walk in, the guy is smoking and reading the paper under the no smoking sign, you know. I said, I need to lift a cheshbon. He goes, this is a loophole. I said, hey, this is a matter. So I go from one window to another window, another window. He lied to me. It was him. He just didn't feel like doing it. You know? So I get back in line. I'm number three in line, and it's almost 1 o'clock when we all have to, you know, take a siesta and, you know, and eat a schnitzel, you know, and, you know, go home, you know, and the whole country closes down for 3 hours, you know? So he looks at me, he says, Mother Ritzel. I said, Ani Ritzel is Liftor Cheshbon. He goes, Yev Shachshav, Ba'achar Ritzel Raim. And I paused for a moment, then I said, Ani Ritzel Liftor Cheshbon. He says, Beseder. I know. So I started screaming, Mi Baruch! I don't know that! So finally, the supervisor comes and I goes, Dibarti Menorchtin! Yeshli et Starazot, Zem must speak, and the whole thing like this, and my broken Hebrew. And she says to the Pakida, he's right. A moment. So she's filling it out, she goes, Lamatza Akta. I said, Lamatza Akta! If I wasn't yelling, you would have sent me back here. I'd have to wait another 2 days, etc. She says, I'm not filling this out. I said, be quiet and do your job. She says, okay. I just, you know, and I was like, gosh, I can't believe this, you know, in America it would never behave this way. So she says to me, so go back to America. That was my welcome wagon here to the State of Israel, where I've decided to sacrifice to make myself part of the national dreams of the Jewish people, you know. But I have to tell you the truth, you know, it takes a very long time for me. You know, I'm here almost 30 years. It takes a very long time to lose that. And whenever I had to go to the American consulate, I have to tell you the truth, I felt a certain sense of pride. Ich bin an American, you know what I mean? You know, I looked at all the things, everybody spoke English. Oh, Mr. Olavsky, how are you? Oh, you're from where? Oh, I have family there from where? Oh, very nice, good pleasure. Chip, Purio, yeah. Just delightful, you know? And then I have to go back out into the big, cruel world, you know? And so it takes a long time. Let's face it, the dominant culture affects us in many ways. Ways that we may be conscious of, ways that we may not be conscious of, you know? And in America, you can find in all the little, you know, Hebrew bookstores and the gift shops, you know, they've got, you know, tzitzis with like Bert and Ernie on it, you know, and Dora the Explorer, you know, like, you know, I don't know if that's really the message that we're trying to bring across, but, you know, the culture becomes part of who we are, you know? Somebody said to me once, since you moved to Israel, he goes, aren't the people rude? I said, yeah. I said, but let the person who hates me be a Jew. You know what I mean? I'd much rather have that than have a nice Jew, nice non-Jew who smiles at me behind my back, and then when, you know, I'll be bleeding in the street, he'll leave me there. You know what I mean? Israelis definitely, we're not the easiest people, you know? I maintain that's because we're family. That's why, you know? And you'll see a mother on the phone, she'll be talking to somebody. Hello, hi, how are you? Could you hold on 1 second? Calm it down! You guys better be quiet or you're gonna get it! Hi, how are you? Now, who's more important to them? Your children, but we take liberties with family. We're not as careful with family. Yeah? Another insight, my own insight, yeah? It says, in Sukkot, you bring first 13, you know, bulls, and then 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, and the last day, 1. So Rashi says, it's to teach us derech eretz, right? The normal way to behave. When you have fancy guests, the first day you serve them the fanciest food, then a little less fancy, then a little less fancy, a little bit, until at the end you're serving them like, you know, lentils. So someone said to me, well, what's the reason for that? I said, it's obvious, you're trying to get rid of them. You know, they won't leave, they don't get the message, you know? I said, that's not the truth. And the truth is, when people make a big fancy dinner for you, you know what I mean? They're telling you you're not family. When they make the same tuna casserole that everybody else is eating, you know what I mean? They serve it to you on the paper plate, then you know you're family, you know? And there's something so special, and you know when you have a simcha in the family, you know, a wedding or a bar mitzvah, you know, and you get all dressed up and you put on your makeup and you get all set up, you know, and, you know, you're wearing the most uncomfortable clothes you can imagine, you know, and you're on show and everything. When you get back home afterwards, everyone takes off, you know, the outfits, they put on their robes, you know what I mean? They all come into the kitchen and they're eating the leftovers that they brought home. That's the sweetest part. That's the most, and anyone who's invited to that, that's family. So as time goes on and I serve you the same thing that my kids eat, then you know that you're family, you know? So the longer you stay, the more that you realize that it's family here, you know? People may take liberties with the way they speak and the way they treat us, but they put their life down on the line for us in a second. And it's a whole different experience, you know? So I don't know what you'd rather have, you know, people who are polite or people who are willing to risk their lives for you, you know? And that's what family is, you know? I was at a cab once, you know, and a guy points to some chassid. He says, see that guy? He hates my guts. I said, I've got a brother. He hates my guts, you know? I said, but I'd give up my life for him. And he turns to me and says, and I'd give up my life for him. And I said, we are one sick, dysfunctional family. You know? That's the problem with this country. But it's takes a while to adjust to it. You know, we come in with a certain mindset. And to be able to take the god of the dominant culture and to slaughter it, whatever that means, you know, you can make your own applications, whatever you think, you know, the god of the outside world is, right? I'm not talking about Jesus, and I'm not talking about Muhammad, and I'm not talking about Buddha. I'm talking about we all have things that we worship and things that we consider to be so important that we're not ready to give up, yeah? And that's what the Pesach is, to shech the god of the Egyptians and put the blood on our doorposts. So I say, I am rejecting the dominant culture and I'm accepting what it means to be a Jew and to have Jewish values. I will step on my soapbox just for a moment. I don't like to do this, but I do from time to time. My father, when I got married, brought me a bottle of Chivas Regal and a bottle of Crown Royal, and he said it'll last you the rest of your life. Because Jews don't drink, right? Jackie Mason says, you'll know at the end of the show who's a Jew and who's a Gentile. Every Gentile will say, you want a drink? Want a drink? And every Jew will say, did you eat yet? Yeah, but I didn't have cake. I had cake and coffee, you know, refreshments, you know. So, you know, yeah, a piece of cake, you know. So, you know, so fine. I knew this for myself because I never drank, you know. I teach their own. I don't know judgments here. I just, you know. To me, scotch comes in three flavors, disgusting, unbelievably disgusting, and undrinkable. You know what I mean? Lafarge falls into the third category, by the way, just so you know where it goes. But, you know, so I have these three yeshiva guys who come to my house Friday night, and they bring a bottle of Chivas. It's a lifetime supply. And when they left, it was empty, and I didn't have any. And I said, we're not in Kansas anymore, Toto. You know what I'm saying? Things were changing. So then people came over, and I said, would you like a l'chaim? So they said, do you have any single malts? I said, was that Chivas or Crown Royal, you know? No, it's Glenfinnich and Glenlivet and Glenmorangie and John Glenn and Glenmiller and, you know, then all the Glens, you know what I mean? So I go to duty free, I bring back a few bottles, and I have to take them off the table because, you know. And you see that there's a certain attitude. Rabbi Kaufman, who's Rosh Yeshiva in Waterbury, said something that was profound. He said, my parents might not have been as mitzvah observant as many people are today, but they were proud Jews. There was an attitude of, this is what a Jew does. And there are some people who don't think like a Jew, even though they may do a lot of mitzvahs. So Korban Pesach is telling us that we have to think like a Jew, have like a Jewish heart, you know? A guy who works on bringing back kids who've fallen off the path and hit the streets, he says, you know, so the Jewish boy, it's pretty easy to bring him back because he can't really make it on the street. He doesn't know how to take a razor and slice up your face. A black kid can, a Puerto Rican kid can, an Italian kid can, an Irish kid can, but a Jewish kid, it's hard for him to slice up your face, you know. Jackie Mason says, you know, a Jew can't be a mugger. He can't say, give me all your money. He says, how much you got? I'm sure we can work out something. You know, there's a Jewish heart, you know. I forgot when this was. This was 10, 15 years ago. There was a soldier, and I forgot what he did. He did something very heroic, and he got killed. And they made all around the country, you know, to raise money for the widow and for the family. I think they raised $5,000. There was a guy on an LL flight. And he looked very, very distraught. And the guy sitting next to him said, what's the matter? And he was sitting with his son. He says, I'm bringing him to America. He needs an operation. It cost $100,000. I don't have the money. I don't know what I'm going to do. When I get there, I'll try to talk to the people there. But, you know, otherwise he's going to die. This guy gets up. It's on the yellow flight. And he walks this way, walks across, walks back up this way, comes back, comes here, heads up the $100,000. It's a Jewish heart. You know, it's a way of thinking, it's a way of looking, that we look out for each other, that we're concerned for each other, that we, you know, even though you may live in a culture where, you know, I'm going back to the 80s, you know, and I remember you see shirts that were like, I'm sorry, do I look like I care, you know, or talk to the hand, you know, I mean, these kind of things, you know, like, you know, who cares, you know. And a Jew can't do that. A Jew feels, you know. Anyway, like I say, fill in whatever you want. Matzazu shanu ochel moshuma. You know, I'm going to skip to Mara first. You'll forgive me. Mara zeh shanu ochel moshuma. Why do we eat Mara? Aushim shemaru hamitzrim eschaye avosenim mitzrayim shenema v'yamaru eschayeim ba'avodah kasha. They embittered our lives with hard work, b'chomi v'levenim, with brick and mortar. V'chol avodah basode, and all the work in the field is called avodosam asher avdu bahem b'farach, and all the work that they had to do, the breaking work. My father, my grandfather was from Poland, and evidently there, horseradish was like a snack food. People would just, you know, it's like when I made the charoses, you know, when you're like, you're grating up the apple and eating a piece of apple, that's like my father was with the horseradish. He'd be grating the horseradish and eating something along with it, like, you know, it was like a snack food, you know. And I went to Hebrew Academy of Nassau County. Parents sent us to a day school. And they said, you can't use horseradish because nobody can eat it. If you grind it up, then you could eat it. But if you eat 1.1 fluid ounces, you know, in order to eat it. And so really the best thing to use is romaine lettuce. I insisted that we have romaine lettuce on the table. My father thought it was the funniest thing he ever heard in his life, you know. And he says, why don't you have horseradish? I said, because, you know, they said in school you can't eat it. And he's sitting there with this big chunk chewing it up. Goes, oh, yeah? You know? I said, yeah, nobody can eat it. It's too hard. He goes, oh, is that right? They made him tough back in Poland, you know what I mean? You know, and that was the bitterness. And he says to me, a lettuce leaf? That's what you're eating? A lettuce leaf? Hey, lettuce leaf is not very bitter. We call them bitter greens, chicory, escarole, you know, romaine lettuce. But bitter? Bitter like horseradish, like real bitterness? We just have to remember the bitterness, because we don't need bitterness. The only reason we have bitterness in our life is because we forget what's really important. And it's sad. Unfortunately, we know it. A secular businessman in Chicago once said to me, most Jews have never heard of Sheva Brachas, but they all know how to say Kaddish, because we're really good at suffering. That's what we Jews do best. I travel around very often. I'm in a shul, and I'm the only one at the end that's not saying Kaddish. Every one of the rooms going, Yizgadal, Yizgadash. I said, what, was there a plague? You know what I'm saying? Half the town died, you know? No, the plague is that the only people who come to shul are the ones who have to say Kaddish, you know? I heard a guy say to somebody once, he says, well, one more week and I'm out of here. I, by then, had developed enough finesse that I didn't say what I was thinking, you know. My wife keeps trying to impress upon me there's a concept called filters, but I've never been able to get them yet. So somebody said to me once, he goes, sometimes you actually pause and you think, is this appropriate? And then you say it anyway, but at least you pause first to think. I mean, that's nice, you know. But I was thinking, I was saying, gee, that's too bad, because I guess if God wants to see you again, he's going to have to kill another one of your loved ones, because that's the only way to get you into shul. Which is kind of sad. And there's somebody who's a bigger cynic than me, if you can imagine it. He said to me once, I finally figure out why people die. Otherwise, we wouldn't have one shul, one mikveh, one yeshiva. They're all named after dead people. You know what I mean? And that's what motivates people, unfortunately. Tragedy motivates people. You know how much you need, the Gemara says, how bad does something have to be for you to question God? If you stub your finger, you say, oh my gosh, why did this happen? That's all you need. And if a person could take, you know, they have these magnets on their refrigerator today. So don't sweat the small stuff. It's all small stuff. We say different. Sweat the small stuff, then you won't have to sweat the big stuff. You know, if something little goes wrong and you use it as an opportunity to become a better person, then I don't have to wait for something dramatic to happen for me to be able to wake up and think, oh my gosh, you know, why did this happen to me? You know, we should always be looking at it. The only bitterness we need in our life is as much bitterness as is in a lettuce leaf. Okay, now let's get to matzah. Matzah zushanu oichlu ma'ashema ashushalom so hispik b'tekim shavasenu la'achmitz ad shenigla aleyem melech malchem lochem kadosh baruch hu ga'olam. That we eat the matzah because their bread did not have a chance to leaven before they were rushed out of Egypt. As it says, they baked the dough as matzos, kilo chametz, because it did not leaven. Kigarshu mitzrayim, they were rushed out of Egypt. And they didn't prepare any food for the journey. People are crazy about matzah. They just get crazier and crazier. When I grew up, we bought Streitz. We used to hear of Aaron Soloveitchik, used to sleep in the factory. That was good enough for us. We were very impressed. Streitz matzahs. Then I got married. My wife's father went to Yeshiva University. He says to me, "You just eat Streitz matzahs? Only 18-minute matzahs. Those are the first 18 minutes, the first run of the matzahs. Those are the ones that you should eat." Okay? We started eating 18-minute matzahs. I came to Israel. 18-minute matzahs? I wouldn't give that to an Arab. Only shmura matzahs. And then, even that's not enough. You have to be in a chabura where they actually go and make it themselves. I did that one year, and I decided that I would never eat any matzahs that I personally participated in the baking of, because, you know, my job was to change those sticks, you know, and where the stick goes into the holder, there's just enough room for this little fleshy part of your hand to fit in. So I don't know about the blood of a Christian child, but there was the blood of a middle-aged Jew in those matzahs, aren't they? You know, but, you know, so people get real nervous about their matzahs, and then they hide them because there are people who believe in chametz radiation. You know what I mean? That's why I have this fight with my wife every year. I want to take out the bottles of wine, which are kosher for Pesach, wipe them down with a rag with bleach, and use them on Pesach. No? No, they were in the chametz cabinet. I said, there's nothing in it. It's a bottle. It's closed, you know? No, go buy it in Cheaper Cola. I said, Cheaper Cola has them out there, too. They have chametz right across with the pretzels, you know? No, it's different. So it's chametz radiation, so people have to hide their matzahs because like you're eating a pita and you look at it, it'll become chametz dick, you know what I mean? So then they take them down and they have their matzahs, and then comes to matzah, and everybody leans, and they measure it out with the little color-coded charts, you know? They take this piece of matzah, and they start shoving it in their mouth because you have a limited period of time, and it doesn't start counting until you swallow it. So their mouth is full of matzah crumbs, and then it makes you laugh, and you spit $30 of matzah all over the table. You have to start all over again. Rabbi Leff says, you know, lechem oni, yeah? It means poor man's bread. He says, it means the bread that makes you poor. You know what I mean? Like, everybody's shoving it down. And I'm sitting here. I'm always the little boy who notices that the king has no clothes, you know? So I said, why are we eating matzah? So they all look at me. Because the Jews left Egypt so quickly, their bread didn't have a chance to leaven. I said, so let it leaven now. If you bake challah dough and it doesn't rise in 18 minutes, you know what you do? Just wait. Might take a half an hour. Take your time. That's the reason? I said, that's not even the part of the story that bothers me. Oh, so somebody said to me, well, it baked on their backs. I said, first of all, it says they baked it when they got there. Second of all, you know how hot it would have had to have been to bake on their backs? You would have fried these people to death. You know what I mean? I said, that's not the part that bothers me. The night before, they eat the Korban Pesach. They have their belt tied, their walking stick in their hand, their sandals on, because they're told God's going to rush them out of Egypt. And at midnight, a cry goes up through the land of Egypt, and everybody starts screaming, get out, get out, get out. And we say, sorry, can't come out till the morning. And so for 6 hours, they're screaming, they're crying, they're banging on the doors, and finally we come out. He says, get out. I said, can't go dressed like this. What do you got? Go through their closet, take all their clothing. You know what I mean? Fine. Can you go now? Well, no, you know, we're going to need some gold, some silver, have expenses. Take our gold, take our silver, take whatever you want. You know, load it all up. Go. I can't. We need instruments for the Red Sea. Why? You'll find out. Yeah? Where's the conservatory? So, okay, get all those, you know? Can you go now? No. Why? We have to cut down those trees. I don't know. Yaakov said so. I start cutting down all the Yatzei Shittim, loading them on the wagons. Can you go now? Nope. We're waiting for Moshe. He's looking for Yosef. Yosef! Yosef. Anyone see Yosef? You know? This takes another 6 hours. Now, for 12 hours, the Egyptians have been screaming, get out, get out, get out. We're finally all ready to go. And all the Jewish people think, what a great time to bake bread. And then we got rushed out of Egypt because, my gosh, who could have seen that coming? And that's why we eat matzah. Whenever I say that, people are like, yeah, yeah. So why were they baking this bread that they baked into matzahs? Not for food. That's the end of the pasuk. V'gam tzei de lo ozulam. They didn't bring any food for the journey. So why did they do this? They did it for us, says the Ramban, as a simen l'doros. Because if you have ever gone to a matzah baking factory, then you know that there is nothing as nerve-wracking as when that water hits the flower and everybody goes crazy. And you have to start kneading, you have to start moving, and it's very, very intense. Yeah? So here we all are, running out of Egypt with this dough on our backs, kneading it to make sure it doesn't become chametz. And less than 18 minutes later, millions of people have traveled 120 mil. Yeah? And they sit down and they go, see that? Didn't become chametz. That's how fast the geula is going to come. And this is such an important point, because it's so hard for us to let go. You know, I was in America. I had a chance to watch the news stations there. And I remember the night of Trump's election, I was watching it here on the internet. And it's just amazing how everyone got it wrong, and so wrong, and how shocked they were. And it didn't stop anybody. The next day, all the talking heads came up, and everybody knows, and everybody's got an opinion, and everyone's going to tell you what is and what isn't, you know, and nothing has changed. Everybody knows everything, yeah? So people say, how in the world is the geula ever going to come? How's Mashiach going to come? You know, Iran's building these nuclear weapons to send at us. North Korea's building nuclear weapons and testing, you know, rockets to be able to send, you know. We're surrounded by people who don't like us, you know, and even outside of Israel. And they're building tunnels to sneak in and to shoot us and to kill us, and all around the world, anti-Semitism, you know. And all of a sudden, at some point, you know, Mashiach's going to show up on a donkey, blow a shofar, and that's going to be the end. And everyone's going to recognize him. Yeah? That's going to have to be one of the funniest things that has ever happened in history. And that's what we say in Shia Malach, Oz Yimale Yischaik Pinu. Then our mouth will be filled with laughter. You know? We are here in Rome, you know, and we're speaking to the Pope. Pope, what do you have to say? We were wrong. Excuse me? Wrong. 2000 years, we were wrong. Take off the white one, put on a black one. That's it. You know? I don't know what to tell you, you know? We were wrong. Find the head of the Mecca. We were wrong. Everybody was wrong. We got it all wrong, you know? Now, how can you even imagine how that's going to play out? That's not the amazing thing. You know how long it's going to take to make all of the things work out? 18 minutes. Now, less than 18 minutes. And in 18 minutes, the geula is going to take place. Somebody asked, I think it was the Kotzke, when is the Mashiach going to come? And he said, whenever we want him. You know? Whenever we want him. Rabbi Meiselman, who has his doctorate in physics from MIT besides being a tremendous Talmid Chacham. I was in Los Angeles when he was living there. They brought him into a school to answer certain halachic questions. So one of the kids said, now that we have satellite communication, when the Beis Din in Yerushalayim announces when the new moon is, we'll know right away. So will we still have to keep 2 days here in Los Angeles? So Meiselman says, well, when Mashiach comes, you're going to all move to Israel. They said, what? Give up all this? That's the problem. The problem is that we have to want it. Korban Pesach is we want it. We're willing to turn our back and say, yes, we want to be part of the Jewish future. We want to be part of the Jewish destiny. Yeah? And how much bitterness would that involve? That's up to us. It could be the bitterness in the leaf of a romaine lettuce. Doesn't have to be any worse than that. And if we accept it and we're willing to put in the effort, then the geula can come in less time than it takes for the dough to turn into chametz. In less than 18 minutes, we can have a geula. Mirza Hashem, it's not too late. We can still have Beis HaMikdash, and you know, I'm a little nervous because I am a Kohen, you know, and I know my kids will be playing with my begodim, you know what I mean, and tie knots in my avnage, you know what I mean, I'll be running barefoot for the bus, you know what I mean, to the old city, you know, to get there. I'm kidding, of course, because they give you the clothes when you get there, but all hands on deck, you know, and it says that the Kohanim used to pass the little bowls of blood from the korbanos up to the mizbeach so fast it looked like a blur. You just saw a straight line of gold and a line of silver, and it was just an absolutely amazing sight. And it's not too late that we can have that opportunity. But if not, yeah, as they always say, Rabbi, wouldn't this be a good time for the Messiah to come? He says, yes, but until he does, we'll just have to wait for him someplace else. In any event, the Seder is that moment where we're able to see the Geula. God is watching over us. All the Kriya Shema Amita we don't say. We just say the first paragraph of Shema and Hamapil, because we don't have to need the protection. It's a Leil Shimurim. God is watching over us. The Mirtzah Hashem, this Pesach will not just be another Pesach. This will be the dramatic Pesach of our lives for ourselves, our children and our grandchildren, our guests and our friends. Thank you very much.